Council. We're meeting this evening because next week, Monday, is a holiday. Typically, we meet on following Wednesday, and there are going to be a number of us out of town, so that's why you're seeing this evening. And if you could have the roll call by the town clerk, please.
Chairman Roberts?
Present.
Counselor Barry?
Yeah.
Counselor Carson?
Here.
Counselor Fritz? Counselor Lynch?
Here.
Counselor McGinty?
Here.
Counselor Swift-Kyoto?
Here.
Representative Gill? Representative Weaver? Town Manager McGovern?
Yep. And the town clerk, Plain.
Thank you.
Do we have the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Well, we'll start to the left tonight. Any reports and correspondence? Anybody over there have anything they'd like to chip in with?
I would like to congratulate Counselor Swift-Kyoto for being one of the directors in the upcoming year for the Maine Municipal Association facilities. And I think that it takes a lot of time and dedication, and I think she's to be congratulated for taking that on and being elected.
Thank you, Henry.
Very good. John?
Nothing.
On this side, anyone have anything? Counselor Lynch?
I have a couple of things I wanted to mention. I'm the council representative to the school building committee project, and I just wanted to mention, because there has been a lot of publicity and a lot of large numbers in the headline, that the school building committee has yet to finish its work, and when it does, any project will be sent to the school board, which has yet to vote on a project, at which point it will be sent to the town council, which will then have an opportunity to vote on it and/or send it out to the public to vote on it. So I just wanted to really let the public know that there's a lot left of this process and a lot of opportunity to get involved, whatever your thinking is on the school project, and make sure that that's clear, because I'm not sure it was entirely clear in the newspaper. Second, I wanted to also mention something about the property tax assessments. As many people know, we are reassessing property taxes, and I've just had a number of people tell me recently that they didn't want to let our property tax assessor, Matt Sturgis, into their house to inspect and evaluate the property. And I just wanted to make sure the public is aware that if they don't do that, they lose their opportunity to appeal later on. So I think it's important for people to understand the ramifications of that. And lastly, I wanted to mention that I was the council representative at a dinner to thank the volunteers who work at the Fort Williams gift shop. And that was a great little dinner to honor and thank people who give a lot of hours to the town, and that gift shop results in a lot of revenue to the town. So I just wanted to take this opportunity to recognize those folks publicly for all the work that they do.
Thank you. Anyone else? No? All right. I have a few comments. First, I'd like to welcome Rhiannon Gill. And Rhiannon is a senior at Cape Elizabeth High School. And as we do this discussion, if you have something you'd like to bring to us from the school, you're more than welcome to put your hand up. Any other items that we're discussing, if you have anything you'd like to share with us or any input, just you can step up, either you or Alex can step up to the mic right next to Counselor Carson and have your say there. We look forward to having your input on it. And I would mention that Alex would be here, except he's at a cross-country meet, I believe, out of town tonight. So he's not just missing it. I also have a couple of other things I'd like to report. I was able to go to the 30th anniversary of the Church of the Nazarene to represent the town. They have a very nice group of folks down there, and I was really pleased to be able to represent the town. I got a copy of an excellent letter from FEMA that on the great shape that the town is in on our flood plan zoning issues. due to the efforts of Bruce Smith, and I'd just like to recognize Bruce for keeping us in such good stead. Usually when Towns gets letters from the DEP and the EPA, they're not good news, so it was always nice to see that one. So I believe that was all I had. I know the town clerk and the town manager are on the agenda, and Debbie indicated she would like to add something, so I'll go to her first, I believe.
Thank you very much. We are about a month out from the November 5th election, if anyone is not aware of that date. Tuesday, November 5th, we will be voting on general election items, and there are two bond issues and a citizen initiative. Absentee ballots are available. We've had a tremendous response already. The state political parties and some other groups have been mailing out absentee ballot requests to folks and so forth. So we've had a very early and very large response to that. Anyone is welcome to vote an absentee ballot now in Maine without cause. You don't have to be out of town, sick, or what have you. So if you'd like to vote an absentee ballot, they're available here at Town Hall. You can go right on our website right now at www.capeelizabeth.com. There is a download printable form for the absentee ballot application. Fax it to us, bring it in, call us. If you need to register to vote, we encourage you to do so. Before Election Day, if possible, we anticipate lines on Election Day. So if you're going to be tight for time on Election Day, please register before. If you are new to our community or just have not registered, we encourage you to do so, although you can do it on Election Day and vote at the same time. Everyone in town votes at the Cape Elizabeth High School Gymnasium from 7 a.m. until 8 p.m. So thank you very much.
Thank you. And last but not least, Town Manager Michael McGovern.
Yeah, very briefly, I wanted to thank everyone for their understanding of our difficulties at the pool since the last council meeting. I think, as everyone's aware, we had some difficulty with chloramines. It wasn't chlorine, it was chloramines, and getting the proper balance as a result of the cleansing agent that was used. And the citizen users of the pool were all extremely patient, and we appreciate that. Also, for Lisa Petroselli, the pool director, it was probably a more agonizing time than one could ever imagine, and trying to run a facility that the water can't be open, and I appreciate her patience and all her persistence in working on the issue, as well as Bernie Shannon, who's with the maintenance department, with the school department, who did an awful lot of work, weekends and otherwise, trying to figure it out and get it going. And finally, the chemist at the Portland Water District. You know, the town hasn't always had the rosiest relationship with the water district over the years, and you know, the water district's really been helpful in recent years at any number of times, and particularly when we get stuck in a situation, sometimes we don't know where to turn. They do have a number of staff members there who are extremely talented, and this particular instance, they were quite helpful in helping us see it through. So I really want to thank Lisa and Bernie and the water district, and then especially all the patrons. For those that have memberships, we'll be extending them all by the appropriate period so that no one will suffer as a result of the close down.
Thank you. And as I look to my left, I notice that Councilor Fritz is here, and I'll give Carol an opportunity to say something. She had something on her agenda. Did you?
I didn't have any report.
All right, then. It should be noted that she has arrived. At this point, we allow any citizen in the audience an opportunity to discuss any item that is not on the agenda, and we do seem to have a few people this evening. Is there anyone that would like to come to the podium and address the council? Please give us your name and address, sir.
My name is Carl Pearson, Russet Lane, and I'm here as... I wasn't sure if the next agenda item is going to have any public input relative to Dr. Johnson's request for a sewer extension, but the information that I'd like to share is sort of related, but not really. Last month, I had the opportunity to attend the planning board, at which Dr. Johnson did get approval to go forth with his construction and renovation and ultimately the relocation of his office to the former community center building at 1226 Shore Road. And a lot of the discussion focused around sidewalks. I'm also here as a former member or a member of the original Town Center Planning Committee that went through all the planning process in 1993, presented the report to the Town Council. Unfortunately, I wasn't on the Town Council when I was on that committee, so I guess I was a lame duck councilor at that point. But I never read the ordinance, and part of the ordinance, as I read it and sat through the time with the planning board, seemed to not carry the spirit that the original committee had, or at least the way that I thought that it was written. One of the passages in that report stated that the town, or the ideal here, recommendations, would say construct and reconstruct sidewalks throughout the town center. And if the sidewalk construction is to be phased, the first priority should be construction of sidewalks along both sides of the Shore Road, extending from the community center to the town hall and from the Scout House to the Methodist Church. Phase two includes the sidewalks from the shopping center and reconstruction of sidewalks on Scott Dyer Road. Phase three is the sidewalks on both sides of Route 77 to the Fowler Road, Old Ocean House roadways. You know, when I saw the ordinance as it's written, it states, and once again, I'm not faulting the planning board, because as one planning board member said, he goes, you know, we like the new sidewalks. It adds to the rural character here. We don't necessarily like requiring new businesses or changes in uses to have a sidewalk parallel to the front facade of the building, but that's the way the ordinance is written. I would ask the council that it might be time to revise or revisit the ordinance, because it seems unfair to me to put the burden of a new sidewalk on new businesses that happen to not be located along the town sidewalks that was put in. I don't think Jerry Murray and Tim Thompson and Century 21, I don't think they had to bear the cost of the sidewalks that the town put in front of their properties. I thought that the whole focus of the town center was to have a cohesive town center at which businesses would like to come to and have sidewalks accessible and connect their establishments to the existing town sidewalks. Because if I'm not mistaken, whatever sidewalks are out there in front of any businesses or buildings are maintained by the town. So I'm just confused here, is the town requiring that new businesses put in sidewalks, but ultimately they're going to be maintained, and I assume the liability is going to be borne by the town for those sidewalks. And why doesn't the town come up with a cohesive plan to install sidewalks? I thought that that was the original intent and the spirit by which the Town Center Planning Committee made that.
Select Kyle, for information, we are meeting with the planning board, and there is a workshop on the town center plan at that point. So,
okay. Great.
And it's November 14th. Thank you. I didn't have my glasses, and I couldn't see that. But it is coming up shortly, and it will be addressed, some of those issues. And
okay. And that's, and I, you know, once again, I haven't been kept abreast as well as I should have, but when the issues come up, and being a patient of Dr. Johnson, I do have some bias there. Anyways, and the last point is that Johnson & Johnson, not to be confused with the large pharmaceutical company, but Dr. Johnson and Everett Johnson, who I guess both going through the same dilemma here, are asked to be installing sidewalks that go to nowhere. And that seems to be, to me, more of a potential liability or a problem. And while I realize the future extension of the sidewalks is the intent of requiring that, right now I think you're causing more of a problem by requiring portions of sidewalks to be built that go nowhere. And the last point, too, and you'll see, I think, from the town center plan, the ending point of this sidewalk, as depicted on that map, ends at 1226 Shore Road. It does not extend beyond that. So those are just a few points. Once again, I didn't want to muddy the waters because I know he's here for a sewer extension, but the two are tied hand in hand, especially when it comes time to construct and potentially reconstruct something. So although the expression says, if it's worth doing, it's worth doing right, I like the expression, if it's worth doing wrong until you get it right. So, thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else would like to speak to an item not on the agenda? Okay. We will move along to the minutes of the meeting on September 9th, number 40203. And do I have a motion to accept those minutes?
So moved.
Second. Yeah. Moved by Councilor Lynch, seconded by Councilor Fritz. Any discussion, comments? All in favor of accepting the minutes as presented then? So it to be unanimous. Item number 230203 was tabled 812 and 99. I would need to have a vote to remove it from the table.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? Item number 220203, proposed vacation of a portion of Bayview Road. This was an item that came before the council to vacate a street that was, and there was a concern that one of the neighbors had that by doing so it may allow some additional development. The council asked the two parties to get together to come up with something that they could both live with. It is my understanding that that has now been done. I know that, I understand that we have parties on both sides with us, and if either of you would like to get up and speak, I know Mr. Keneally had asked for a second, so Jack, if you'd like to start it, you're more than welcome.
I'm Jack Keneally, 16 Highview Road. The only reason I wanted to speak was to thank the council very much for giving us the opportunity to construct a private agreement that addresses the concerns that I brought to the council 2 months ago. And we have now completed that agreement, and you know, thank you very much to all the council members for giving us that opportunity.
Mr. Thalen, would you like to add anything? Or? Wait just a second. Name and address, too, please, or business.
Paul Thielen for Mr. Panansky. Just to confirm that, in fact, an agreement has been signed, I have the original of it here. The intention of the parties are that, or at least it's my intention, representing Mr. Panansky, that assuming the council grants an order of vacation, that order would be recorded in the Registry of Deeds. That's required under the statute. And we would immediately thereafter record this agreement. And I indicated that to Mr. Keneally. He's gone over the agreement, as his attorney. And I think everyone is satisfied with its form and content. I can give you a copy of the signed agreement.
If you'd like
agreement.
To give it to the town clerk, I think probably the best person. Thank you very much. Do I hear a motion from the council or Mr. McGovern?
Yeah, I would just like to recommend that the council adopt the order with the understanding that the original of the agreement be given to the town attorney and that our town attorney would do both filings. That way we ensure that everything's filed that needs to be filed.
So moved.
So moved. Thank you very much. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? Councilor Berry.
Just a question. Is there an appeal period here that has to expire before this will be final? And if so, then perhaps we ought to wait before recording it until that appeal period has expired. Just a question. I have no objection. I mean,
there is a period under the state paper street statute.
Right.
That I'm not an expert in the statute, but I recollect it's a year that anyone who owns property in the subdivision could conceivably challenge it.
Maybe.
For a year?
I believe it's... Mm-hmm. I'm not an expert, but that's my recollection.
I think we may have an expert coming to the podium.
Studied the statute more recently than I have.
Yeah.
You sure? I don't pretend to be any expert, but my understanding of the statute is that there is that year period that Mr. McGovern mentioned from the recording of the order.
Okay.
And it's during that period that anybody can come forward and assert a claim if they have one.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Roger.
We have a motion. We have a second. Anyone else would like to discuss it? All right. All in favor of the motion? So it to be unanimous. Item number 430203. A request from Dr. Craig E. Johnson for an extension of the sewer line on Shore Road to provide sewer service for 1226 Shore Road. This is being brought forth by myself, having been on the prevailing side of an issue that was voted on previously. In the audience with us, we also have Dave Griffin, the chair of the planning board, and Maureen O'Meara, the planning director, as well as Dr. Johnson. I would ask the town manager if he would give us just a quick update on this one.
Would you like me to do that after there's a motion to reconsider?
Yes.
It didn't say to reconsider, did it? Yes, we need a motion to reconsider.
So moved.
So moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
And a second. All in favor of reconsidering? You show that to be unanimous also. Thank you.
Thank you.
Somebody's going to keep me in order here.
Yeah. This was at the council a month ago, and it was denied. I think, you know, some additional information's come up too then. Has come up since then. One is that there's a memo that was in your boxes, and most of you have seen it, from Bruce Smith to Maureen O'Meara, Bruce Smith, code enforcement officer, to Maureen O'Meara, the town planner, that indicates that the septic system on the property, according to Al Crick, the soil scientist, is not of, it's not going to last a whole long time. Mr. Crick believes it has a very short-term duration. That is contrary to the information that was provided a month ago, and I think is substantial in its impact. As to the sewer itself, you know, as I look at the whole town center, much of what's been accomplished has been the result of a number of public-private partnerships. You know, as was alluded in Citizen Pearson's comments, you know, the town has gone in, has put in some sidewalks. The town has gone in, put in quite a bit of drainage. The private sector has done things. You know, I think when one looks at the shopping center now compared to 15 years ago, all of the landscaping that was put in along 77, the new planters that are there along the brick wall there, it really looks an awful lot better. You know, and I could, even the house that's between the Key Bank and the town lot next door, as recommended by the town center, they moved all the parking from the front of the house down around the back, which was one of the other recommendations. So there's been an awful lot that goes on. Within the town center, one of the recommended items is the preference is that everything be on sewer, because it isn't a commercial zone. You know, the quantity, sewer levels are unknown, and, you know, it's my belief that this property should be on sewer. As Carol would know, I believe everything ought to be on sewer. But anyway, particularly in the town center, I believe it ought to be on sewer. I thought I'd say that before you did. And then I think, you know, the next issue is, should the town pay for it? And, you know, it is a more difficult issue, but, you know, if you look back at when the town marketed the property, which was in the February, March period of this year, in the document that we put out, we indicated that sewer, water, and I think cable were available to the property. That was the line used.
Right.
It wasn't clear, you know, obviously the property already has water. I don't recall if the property had cable, but it's immaterial because you can hook it up. But the sewer is a different animal because there's an expense of about $8,000 to $9,000 to do it. The council looked at that issue in May, the May 13th meeting, and recognizing that it was unclear, did agree to have the town pay the sewer connection fee. It wasn't waived. The town actually remitted the $3,000, the requirement to get $3,000, to the sewer fund. So, you know, it was actually paid. At this point, you know, I think even though that, if you read that May decision, it's on a chronology you have before you, it does indicate that the vote at that time was that we would pay the connection fee, that the applicant would pay the sewer connection. You know, I think a number of issues come up. It's a lot closer because of the documented need in terms of when it needs to be done. It also, you know, there is the sidewalk issue, and you know, it's not the council's role to overrule individual actions of the planning board. You know, as is mentioned, there is a workshop on November 14th, and you can look at the larger issue, but you don't have the authority under all of the rules you've developed over the years to specifically overrule them. However, but because this sidewalk is being required, it does raise the issue of, you know, the sewer really ought to go in now before the septic system fails. And, you know, it's just muddy enough that I think the council and the community ought to step forward and do what I would refer to as the honorable thing. And, you know, one can debate, one can argue, reasonable folks can disagree on this. But, you know, I would recommend that the town do the connection, undertake the connection, and that the funds to accomplish that purpose be expended from the sewer fund, so it wouldn't be any direct cost to the taxpayers. And, you know, over time, it is paid back in user fees, although it did, admittedly, at $8,000 or $9,000 for connection, it would take some time. So I would recommend, Mr. Chairman, that the council approve the request of Foxtrot Properties LLC, the technical owner of the property, to provide a sewer extension to the property and physically connecting the property.
May I make that motion?
Certainly.
I make it.
Second.
Any discussion from council?
Get this guy in business.
Yes. Yeah, right.
Unbelievable what's happening.
Now, if I keep looking to the right, I'm safe, right?
Absolutely.
Oh, wow. Go ahead, Councilor Fritz.
I'm just wondering how much money is in the sewer fund at this time.
Because of the mess on Montgomery Terrace and Glen Avenue, we only have, as of June 30th, we only had about $25,000 in the sewer fund, which is at a historic low. We do anticipate this year that, you know, so far, because of the dry summer, folks did a lot more watering that didn't have submeed. It's been hotter. There's been more showers. It's trending relatively well. But, you know, it's what's really helped us the most, quite frankly, is sewer connection fees with Cross Hill and other things. That's what's kept us going. But it's low. But, you know, we have a historic antipathy. Is that right? To raising sewer fees, and you know, if I really looked at it, we're right on the margin of having to do that, but I still want to put it off for a couple of years and try to find ways. Yeah, the good news is our sewer debt service is being paid off at a rapid pace now, and that's going down. But there is only about $25,000 in the sewer fund.
But if I might ask again, wasn't there a sewer project that we had intended to do in the northern part of town that we are not doing, that we, because of the Montgomery Road area?
That's right. We've been trying to replace the almost 100-year-old sewers now, beginning on Cottage Farms Road, Birchwood, Maple
Elmwood.
Thank you, Elmwood. And we were heading over to Island View. That project is about $150,000 or more. And we're nowhere close to doing that. You know, an $8,000, $9,000 swing, you know, isn't going to move that into one construction season or another. I really think, you know, I hate to mention this, but you know, one of my goals this year is to look at the entire Northern Cape sewer and to come up with a plan to replace all those 100-year-old sewers. And what that will probably result in a bond that would be repaid over the sewer fund. And you know, what I need to do is do the fiscal analysis to make sure we can do that in such a way as other debts declining so that we're not actually going to cause an impact on sewer fees. I don't want to, you know, the community's sewer fees are amongst the highest, and we don't want to. I understand that.
I guess another question I had is what changed Mr. Frick's mind in terms of the septic system? I mean, he did say that it was okay before.
My sense is we had incomplete information last month.
From Mr.
Well, did he evaluate the system before you went to the planning board?
Dr. Johnson, you need to identify yourself.
Okay, Greg Johnson. When you presented information from Mr. Frick at the last council meeting, that was information I had not even seen yet nor received. His evaluation had just been completed, and I didn't have a report, and we had been trying to track that down, and I had assumed that he had forwarded that information on to the town and to Bruce Smith before he had sent it on to me. So I can't answer for what the basis of the information was that you folks had, only it was my guess that it was something that you had obtained from Mr. Frick. So I have not seen Bruce Smith's final comments to you then, either indicating his reassessment of the septic system.
So did the town have Mr. Frick look at it, or?
I would stand by what I said earlier. We had incomplete information.
No, I had asked Mr. Frick to come and evaluate it at my expense, because of the planning board's hesitancy to approve the project without some firm information. And that had happened almost immediately, you know, well, within the week before the town council met. And so I think there was information flying back and forth, and the validity of it, I guess, was not quite clear.
Thank you.
Well, I still maintain that the septic system at that site, and I don't know whether it's adequate or not, but it seemed to be functioning when it was used as a community center, which is going to, was a lot more use than Dr. Johnson would be using for his facility. I mean, people don't take showers and do, you know, and, well, they didn't take showers at the community center, but, I mean, it's not like a house. I'm very much concerned about the sewer fund that we have for replacing sewer lines. And I think we have a lot of old sewer lines that it seems to me are a higher priority than this. I would not require Dr. Johnson to connect to the sewer. I also would not require him to have a sidewalk. Because it's at the end of the town center area, it doesn't go anywhere. There's no subdivision that you're attempting to have access a sidewalk and get to the town center. These requirements just don't seem necessary to me. And I think funds are tight, and so we should put them toward where we have real priorities of needs.
I would ask Town Manager McGovern if he would respond to that.
I want to respond to the first part. I'm not going to respond to the second part.
All right, I will.
This is from a memo, September 11th, 2002, to Maureen O'Meara from Bruce Smith. Since the packets have to go out this afternoon, I contacted Mr. Frick, who has concluded that although the design flow proposed for the first phase does not exceed the design flow required for the prior use as a community center, the actual system currently in the ground is minimal at best for the use proposed, and therefore he, as an expert in the field, is recommending replacing the system at this time. And, you know, that's part of one of different four paragraphs. So I, you know, Mr. Frick, you know, no one has ever doubted his expertise in this field. And, you know, I would just hate to see us have a potential sewer contamination problem here in the town center, and I think it's really important for this property to go on. So.
And Councilor Fritz, I'd like to, it was mentioned earlier that there's a lot of us that don't agree that the sidewalk should be going any further than the driveway, but that is the way that the planning board is interpreting it. That's their prerogative, and we really don't have any authority this evening to overrule that, nor should we. And so we're left with, can we help out on this, and on the sewer end at least. Councilor Lynch.
I guess I just have a question. If we're going to use public funds to pay for the sewer extension, will that line be designed and capable to add any existing businesses or houses up to the terminus of that line? So that if someone else's septic system fails, or they just need to replace it, can we make, if we're going to extend it, can we do it so that other parties, residents, can tap into it?
No, we cannot, unless we wanted to spend more than double what is in the sewer fund. You know, this will in essence be a force main from his property. If we went the full distance because of the elevation issues and because of the need for a terminating manhole and a pump station, at the end of that terminating manhole, we'd be bearing, you know, an expense, as, you know, Councilor Fritz well points out, well in excess of the resources in the sewer fund. It's not a permanent solution.
I hate to expend money in a way that, to me, is short-sighted. I would rather, if there's sufficient money in the sewer fund, $25,000, do it the right way the first time. And I don't know if you can do that for $25,000.
You cannot.
Okay, that's
you cannot do what would need to be done with a terminating manhole for the full sewer extension.
What would it take to do what needs to be done as opposed to benefiting?
It would be approximately double that.
It would be $50,000.
Yes. And there's no one else, you know, who is in an immediate need that we have heard from or that we have any knowledge of who is in immediate need of sewer. The ones further down the road, you know, have indicated that, you know, over historically that they prefer not to have sewers. And, you know, it just has not come up as an issue that no that it has ever come to me.
What is the Scout House?
Councillor Carson.
Well, I think in listening to Councillor Lynch, talking about between this road and the community center, which would be the insurance agency, the Scout House agency, the little dentist and stuff.
Pearl Street.
And that's, you know, yeah, that's the kind of thing. I think it's really unfortunate to expend the money to support Dr. Johnson, which I think we should do, if we can only have a forced main there. And I certainly was willing to support that tonight because I think he should open business tomorrow morning. And I don't see how to accomplish that. But given the fact that there are three or four other businesses right there, and given the fact that we can only put a forced main in, I know what that's like because we have several forced mains that in areas that could benefit from sewers that we're unable to hitch up to them because you can't hitch up to a forced main. It's not a collector system. And I hesitate to say this, but to solve his problem, is it better for us to put in a new, bigger septic system on his land to meet his first phase and second phase needs and not put in a forced main, which we can only hitch that one office building up to? Is that an alternative? I mean, my direction tonight is to solve Dr. Johnson's problem as quickly as possible. But it is too bad to have four businesses between the corner and his business who will never be able to hitch up to the sewer because we have a forced main in the road. So is it a solution to put in a new, bigger, better septic system?
I would not recommend putting in a septic system because of the long-term issues of septic systems, because we have no control of what goes into the system, and because we have no way of collecting revenue from the system to pay back our initial investment. Mm.
Councilor McGinty, you?
I was going to ask about the Scout House. They're on septic? They're not on sewer?
They're on septic.
How old is that system then?
150 years.
Maybe Ms. O'Meara could explain the sewer status of the other properties that have been referenced.
Aren't you glad you came tonight?
Absolutely. I can't tell you all the properties because they haven't all been before the planning board yet.
Maureen, could you identify yourself, though?
I'm sorry. Maureen O'Meara, town planner.
Thank you.
But the Scout House, which is being renovated as an office building, has been approved for connection into the public sewer. And their connection, as best I remember, you know where the front door is to the old building? Mm-hmm. The sewer is basically right in front of that front door in Shore Road. So they are planning to connect to the sewer.
It's already there?
Yes.
Doesn't make sense. So just down the one side, we have to put the force main down one side, but the opposite side of the road.
I know that's where they're connecting. They may have to go up the street a little bit, and I don't have the plans in front of me, but I know when we were looking at Dr. Johnson's commitment, we were looking at measuring from the front of that building about 190 feet. So they may have to go up a bit, but it's always been included as part of their proposal that they would connect to the sewer.
Who's they? You mean the Scout House?
The Scout House. Whatever applicant, whatever project we were talking about, connection to the public sewer, was always part of their application.
So those two houses on the other side, the insurance agency and the Scout office, can be hooked up to the collector system as we know it now.
I wish I could tell you for sure whether they're connected, but I just don't trust my memory. We do have site plans on that. I could check that for you.
No, but it could be. If it's a collector system that runs there, we could get those.
That could already hook up to the existing system.
That's to the existing. That's existing what I mean, system.
So the existing system goes down to, it sort of terminates at the end, at the front door, so to speak, of the Scout House?
I'm going to say it terminates close enough to the Scout House that no one has ever said they wouldn't connect to it. How's that?
Okay.
And if they have to extend in Shore Road, the connection point would be basically where that front door is right now.
And Maureen, so the other buildings on the other side of the street theoretically could also connect in, because most of them are up far enough, is that correct, other than maybe the Murray property?
Unless, as long as there's adequate capacity.
And I'm always hesitant to, particularly after the faux pas that was made 4 months ago, I'm hesitant to making any assurances without detail checking the record, so I would caution everyone to be careful.
It's about...
No. Theoretically, those solutions are there, but they may not be, and the money for this could just solve the problem at some point. Yes, you may have to, if the other properties up the street cannot hook in, you might have to go back, you might have to backtrack, but...
Well, I'm ready to support the...
Maureen, thank you. Any further discussion? Move the question then. All in favor of the motion as presented? All opposed? Show it to be 6-1. Councilor Fritz. Thank you, Dr. Johnson. Thank you, Maureen. We have one more item that you folks may want to wait for, though.
More than one.
Or a couple more, yeah. Since you're out enjoying the evening anyway. Item number 450203, acceptance of donations of pedestrian easements from Graham and Susan Pillsbury and Louise Sullivan of pedestrian easements from the Highlands Trail to Two Lights Road. This item has been discussed previously by the Conservation Commission with as part of the project of the church property that had the pond on it behind the little nursery school that's on Two Lights Road. And the intent is, from this easement, to bring enable people to be able to go to that pond and to get in from the Broad Cove neighborhood and out to Two Lights Road without having to go through the other neighbor's properties. And Pillsbury's and the Sullivans have been gracious enough to offer us a pedestrian easement that accomplishes what the neighbors down there would like. So at this point, I would ask the council if someone would be willing to move acceptance of this donation.
I move.
Second.
Any discussion from any of my councilors? Councilor Swift-Cayetta.
Comment does not pertain to the item itself, but I would like noted for the record that somehow we, at least as I understand it, we have skipped item number 44. We seem to have gone from 43 to 45. So just for the record, is that incorrect?
43 was the number from last month, the reconsideration.
Thank you very much.
And 44 was at the end of last month's agenda.
I have a couple of questions.
Councilor Berry.
I notice in the wording of the easement as proposed here, it says that the purpose for following public recreational activities only, as defined by statute, to wit, walking, jogging, skiing, hiking, and sightseeing, as well as to provide access for general education activities. I'm not sure what that means, and it's pretty broad, and I don't know whether we're going to take the University of Maine over there to look at birds, or what would the educational activities include. I'm not sure exactly what that language means. That's my one question, and the other question is, it says nothing shall, the operation by the grantee. The grantee of this easement is the town of Cape Lizard.
That'd be the Sullivans and the Pillsburys.
No, the town's the grantee.
Yeah, the grantee.
If they're the grantor.
I think I'm right.
Yeah.
I think he is.
You are.
You think I'm right?
I think I'm right.
You're right. The grantor is...
The property owners, and the grantee is the town of Cape Elizabeth.
That's right.
That's what I'm talking about. And it says there's no operation by the grantee would be the town of ATVs and so forth. My second question is, what about other people? If the town is not operating, it says further on page 2 here, the operation by grantee of, quote, all-terrain vehicles, end quote, is that just defined, or other motorized or mechanized vehicles within or on the property is prohibited. But it says the operation by the grantee. Now, the town is not going to run in with a truck, but what about other people who are entitled to go on there as citizens of the town or visitors? Is the town itself as grantee the only one prohibited from going on there with ATVs? I don't want to put these people in a position of having to put up with a lot of truck traffic or anything that's not intended by this easement. That's just my concern.
Ms. Zamora, would you, you're familiar with the language in these easements, having done quite a few of them, could you shed some light on this issue for us?
Well,
first question was general educational activities. What do you have in mind?
I'm not going to presume to describe what was in the mind of the town attorney when he drafted these easements. But they were drafted by the town attorney for two private property owners who are offering these easements with no compensation to the town.
Right.
And they were willing to grant us these rights.
I just want to make sure that they know what they're granting here.
The Sullivan, both the Sullivans and the Pillsbury's were encouraged to take as much time as they needed to review them. In fact, the Sullivans had their own attorney review them, asked us to make several changes to them,
mm-hmm.
were specifically concerned with traffic by motorized vehicles and mountain club bikes, and in the end agreed that they were satisfied with the language. If they weren't, we would have kept revising it until they were.
Councilor McGinty?
If we hold the easement, which we will,
right,
can we enact ordinances to control the use of that easement?
Yes, I think we can.
I think so.
Let me answer that.
Fine.
The town has two different roles in this matter. One is you have the legislative body of the community, and you have the right throughout the town to enact ordinances.
Sure.
You're also being asked, separate and apart from that duty, which is always there, to sign an agreement with an individual party as to certain responsibilities for each party. Predominantly, since the town's accepting the easement, the restrictions go on us. In that matter, you're duty-bound to honor those restrictions that are set forth in the easement. Did I answer it, John? Two totally separate functions of the council. One is a holder of an easement with a private, this is in essence a private contract between the town and the two donating parties,
mm-hmm.
and then you also have the legislative right to enact ordinances
that
may or may not be in conflict.
Right.
However, you're still duty-bound by this private contract.
I think that the point is that this language seems to prohibit the grantee, the town, using ATVs on this, but it doesn't prohibit anyone else from
using ATVs.
So if indeed these very generous citizens who are sort of giving over the use of their land to the town, if they are interested in there not being ATVs there, they can either write it into this or, as Councilor McGinty points out, enact it through some sort of statute.
That's right.
And I don't know if we have any statutes that pertain, we in the town have any statutes that pertain to, on greenbelt trails, there shall be no mechanized ATVs or motorbikes or whatever.
All-terrain vehicles are prohibited on municipal properties.
But that's municipal properties, but are they prohibited on greenbelt trails?
That is municipal.
Well, that would become an easement.
Yeah. Not worth looking at in the ordinance, anyway.
But,
Councilor Lynch?
I think Councilor Swift-Kayata and Councilor Berry and McGinty all raised a very good point. And, in fact, if I were the grantor, I would not want to rely on what town council may or may not do from time to time as we, it changes, the town council can change the ordinance, so if indeed it is their intent to have other than the grantees not be able to use ATVs, then it ought to be in the deed, which would then preclude the town council from allowing it as a permissible use at some further point in time. It also makes me a little concerned as I read it. It says, or other motorized vehicle. And I guess I have a question for the town planner. Would there be occasion for the town to want to, say, bring in a pickup truck or something that would, or fire truck, to lay the trail? So I think we ought to accept this or work on some additional language to make sure that it reflects the town's needs to maintain and the grantor's desires, presumably, to preclude those kind of vehicles.
Yes, we could. There's two things we could do. We could obviously add, and the general public. And I think in the other easements that I've seen over the years is that the it generally specifies that in the easement that the town has the ability to bring in equipment for maintenance, and that is not seen here for some reason.
We could not just add that as a council, because this is a legal document where they're giving over their rights.
I would ask the council table this item. I can't make a motion, so I can discuss why before someone makes it.
I'll make the motion.
Do I still before?
Go ahead, you're before, yes.
And I would like to say, this is a very generous offer by two parties.
Right, exactly.
We're trying to protect them.
And I know you're trying to protect them, but it would help in the future. You know, this could have all been addressed and looked at prior to the council meeting. You know, this document's been in circulation for a bit, and it's really difficult. You know, we don't have a town attorney here, and it's, who drafted it, and, it'd be really nice to know some of these questions. I know that the business ought to be done in public, but it'd be really nice to know some of these questions before the meeting so that we're not sitting up here as non-attorneys trying to be attorneys. Legal advice.
Councilor Roberts, if I could just add, I agree with the manager that it would be best if we raise questions beforehand. Unfortunately, I didn't notice it, and I have a feeling a lot of us didn't, and thanks to the eagle eyes of Councilor Barry, he did notice it, and I think we do want to make sure we do not abuse these very generous citizens who are doing something very good for the town.
Mr. Chairman,
citizens. Don't let it be forgotten. My first comment was I believe this should be tabled.
Yes.
And by the way,
yes.
I would move to table this to the next meeting, and in the meantime, we can check with the grantors in each case to make sure that the language reflects their wishes.
We're not under any time obligation with this, right?
No.
None.
The Conservation Commission met last night, and in anticipation of you approving this, they've already scheduled some work to begin installing the trail, which, of course, we will be delaying now.
That's fine.
Does a table need a second?
Well, before we second it, because once it's seconded, we can have no more discussion. I just have a question or want to ask about something on the cover page memo where it says once these easements are accepted by the council, the Conservation Commission will be able to install a trail to Two Lights Road. When that is complete, the commission will then construct the trail to the pond on the St. Bart's easement. I presume that by that, it's the Chinquette property trail, and this is still leaving us enough time. My question is this still leaving us enough time if we do the Pillsbury-Sullivan branch first and then do the Chinquette branch second? We have a time limit for getting the Chinquette branch done, and I want to make sure we preserve our opportunity to do
that. The problem is that in these areas, especially on the St. Bart's, the pond area, it's extremely wet. So even though we have until 2004, we really only have during dry periods to go in there and construct.
Yes, that's
And that's why the commission was very excited last night about trying to get the Two Lights Trail in this fall before, after the leaves come down, before the snow is too deep. And then next spring, they could do whatever we're going to need to do to get a contractor or whatever involved and getting the boardwalk constructed to the pond. With this delay, my guess is that we're looking at trying to put the Two Lights Trail in next spring after it dries out. And then, so we're pushing everything back potentially 6 months. The deadline on the St. Bart's easement is 2004.
It hasn't been seconded yet, so we can still discuss this. I'm wondering, can we accept this ACCEPT subject to, before filing, going back to the grantor? No, okay. The only practicing attorney, the council says no.
I have a question for Ms. O'Meara. Why does the Sullivan-Pillsbury branch have to be constructed first?
It was the condition of the council and of the planning board that that be constructed prior to the St. Bart's section, because the concern was otherwise people don't do very well at a dead end. They tend to keep going instead of turning around. And so the idea was, if you give them a straight trail through to Two Lights Road, that will be the main branch of the trail, and then the trail that goes to the pond will be more like a destination point where people go visit the pond and then turn around. Mm-hmm. If we put in the St. Bart's one first, there was some concern, I believe, originally raised by the council, mm-hmm. that people will just keep right on going, and in fact, my understanding is that that's what they do now.
Well, my overriding concern at this point is that we don't end up losing our opportunity to put in the St. Bart's branch. I do recall that discussion. Thank you for reminding me. It was indeed the council that had that concern, but I think the council at that point was thinking this, that we sort of had a longer time frame, a more drawn-out time frame, and now we're bumping up against a constraint here, and it is my firm desire that we make sure that the St. Bart's piece be constructed within the time frame. So perhaps we can think outside the dots, and I mean, I'd be willing to entertain at one of our workshops having a special council meeting or something to vote just on this, just that we need to think of some way to make this happen. I don't want to lose the season and put everything back 6 months just because, unfortunately, the language doesn't work quite right at this point.
The difficulty with scheduling is we have a workshop tomorrow night.
Mm-hmm.
The chance of resolving this with all the different parties who need to be involved, you know, in the 24-hour turnaround just shouldn't be done anyway.
No, I wasn't proposing it tomorrow night.
And beyond that, there aren't any other workshops scheduled until after the next council meeting. And unfortunately, the next council meeting is the very latest day it can be in November. It's November 13th.
Well, I would be...
Councilor Barry.
It would be acceptable to me, just to finish my comment, Jack, it would be acceptable to me to schedule an additional special one-item council meeting to vote on this. You know, if we could do it 2 weeks from now, if we could get the language worked out. I think it's really important that we get this done. But, of course, there are six other councilors. So. Mm-hmm.
Councilor Barry had his hand up, and then...
No, I was going to say exactly that, a special meeting. I'm willing to come in and do that.
I'd support that.
Well, it's all right. I was saying that it isn't totally frozen in November until into December. You'd have a couple of weeks after the meeting to work. But if you want to do a special meeting, that's fine with me, too.
I mean, maybe we can do this in a very short time and then come right in and do it and vote on it.
Within a week or
so. You were
just concerned about these property owners.
You had made the motion to table. So do you want to say to postpone this or to table it to a date specific, or the first available workshop or a special council meeting or something to that effect?
First available date, I suppose, for a special council meeting.
All right. Do I hear a second on that?
Hang on.
Wait.
Sorry. But if there's any further discussion, once we second it, we can't talk about it.
No, he took the tabling motion off.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, he's making another motion now.
These cough drops. My head is reeling.
So the motion was to refer this item to the first available special date council meeting, and with the date being left open at this point, we'll decide that later.
I apologize. I'm sorry.
Any discussion on that? Councilor Fritz.
Well, I'm just wondering how much time it's likely to take to get the work done that's needed.
A couple of days.
Oh,
I'm not sure. I mean,
it isn't actually constructing anything, isn't it? It's mostly cutting brush and...
Oh, well, yes. However, there have been other volunteers in the neighborhood who have agreed to help, and whenever you want to do something like that, you really need to give a couple of weeks' notice to people in order to get people out there. In addition, we'd like to get a surveyor out there at the same time to mark the trail to make sure we don't accidentally put it off of where our easements and our town-owned land are located. So we are coordinating some different schedules there.
We can do this like in a week or 10 days.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not like we're asking the attorneys to look at an entire document, really. It's just the phrase to be sure that the landowners are protected from ATVs going through there.
We if I might, you know, we don't set the timetable. This is the offer of a gift. And, you know, those who are offering the gift, you know, we have to rely on to work with them on a timetable. Obviously, we will try to move it along, but we can't give you any deadlines because it's their offer. They determine the timetable.
My preference would be just to accept it tonight and then put our own restrictions on it later, and that gets rid of the time issue. But we could legislate that there'd be no motorized vehicles and the town could put their maintenance equipment, et cetera, that could be laid on later. And we could accept this tonight and get it over with, but I won't push the issue.
Not our
easement. No, but we have the right to, on our easements, say that we could do that later.
The only thing is that we were concerned about an ordinance. I don't think there's any question here that everybody here is extraordinarily grateful to these two families for making this work for the town and for the citizens for the future. And there is nothing wrong with this easement except that we feel that the landowners are not protected properly. I mean, it is for them that we have this one concern here. And I think if you put an ordinance on it, you guys tell me all the time, you know, don't make things that the future councils can't uphold. You know, and I think an ordinance is something that can be changed, as we well know. And this is a particular area where you don't want to change an ordinance. I mean, you don't want an ordinance that can be addressed at future times. In an easement, you can't. And it would be my recommendation. I think that the two families have got to know, despite what the manager said, that we are so grateful for this gift and that it has made this whole thing work. And I'm grateful for Mario Romero, who's putting all these people together here. And it would just seems to me if we could just get on this as quickly as we could. I mean, I'm not talking a month. I'm talking a week. Or 10 days. I'm sure that the landowners would be happy if their lawyer had an opportunity to check that phrase and our lawyer had an opportunity to check that phrase. And if they say, hey, it's a go with us, it's covered, we feel comfortable with it, we'll come back in and we'll vote for it. But I really think that Councilor Barry has raised an issue that is of some concern to the landowners, to the gift givers.
And what about the general educational?
The general education to me is a simple thing. We're going to teach you all about polywogs out there.
I don't think you're up to it.
I think that education clause is in, like, the easement to the poor farm. And, you know, it's just that kids could go out in classrooms for
nature
observations. Yeah.
Absolutely, yeah.
So is this possible, Mr. Manager, to... Is it possible to get their attorney or our attorney? Is it possible to check with one of those attorneys to see that if they are properly covered by this?
Our process would be first to speak to the two individual parties, the Hillsburys and the Sullivans.
Right.
So.
We don't have a second.
Well,
then to come.
We get the message. You know, we'll work on it, and you know, it's fine. And you know, we'll try to move it along, but
we'll
call tomorrow. But you know, some of these folks aren't always home, and
we run into these issues. Council meeting. I mean, it's not going to go to November. I can't believe that.
Is there a second to Councilor Barry's motion?
Second. What was the motion? Do you think?
What was the motion?
To the next, the earliest possible moment or something like that.
Earliest possible council meeting.
Moment.
Thank you.
Moment, yeah.
So you said table? Henry said table?
No, didn't use the word table. We used refer to...
It was Debbie's got the motion.
got this crossed out about three times. The last I had was refer to.
All right, refer to is good enough.
So refer it to the next possible meeting.
We understand the intent of the council is table this to return at the earliest possible time.
At a special meeting if necessary.
Right, and we've indicated our willingness, at least four of us have indicated a willingness to come in for a special meeting.
Sure.
We understand perfectly.
Any further discussion? Can we move this one along? All in favor?
Voting.
Unanimous. Thank you.
We're not making work for them, Maureen. Honest. I know I don't... They may not have to change their schedule at all.
She's on a set schedule right now, so...
Yes, I know she is.
Item number 460203. Receipt of a report from the Planning Board recommending an amendment to the zoning ordinance in order to clarify how open space requirements are applied to subdivisions in multiple zoning districts. And I spoke with the Planning Board Chair earlier this afternoon, and Dave said he'd be willing to explain this one for us. So, David, you're on, if you would. Give us just a quick explanation of what the Planning Board has done here. Suit yourself. It was your chance to shine.
Lately, what we've been finding is that the town has these open space zoning provisions, which in the old ordinance we called the cluster development provisions. They were written to provide some flexibility to promote compact neighborhoods and save open space. Unfortunately, we seem to be finding a couple of court decisions that are coming down that are starting to narrow what we can actually use in these provisions, and the narrowing is much tighter than what our original intent was when we wrote them. So what we've been doing is we've been starting to draft changes to accommodate these court decisions and still preserve the original intent. In this case, we have an open space zoning provision that says that if you have a piece of property, you can calculate the density that's allowed on the property, and then you can build all of your development on one section of it. And what that does is it allows you to protect large contiguous pieces of open space instead of spreading the development throughout the project. Unfortunately, there's been a recent court case with the town of Kennebunk where they had a large development and it happened that the land was divided by a zoning line. So a portion of the land was in one zone and then a portion was in the other zone. And what we would like to do and what we've always anticipated doing is that you calculate the amount of density that you're allowed in Zone A, you calculate the amount of density that you're allowed in Zone B, you combine those, and then you put the development on the most appropriate location on the lot. The decision that came out for the town of Kennebunk said that if you move it around, you still have to respect the zone densities with that zone line in the middle. And so what this is saying is that you still calculate the density based on the zoning, but then you can move the development anywhere on that lot that you would like, as long as the overall density is not exceeded. This is something that was anticipated when the 1997 open space zoning provisions were written, and we actually did some studies on some property off of Wells Road to show how we could preserve open space by shifting development to one side or the other. So that's what this amendment is supposed to do. Questions?
Thank you. I think that perhaps the best thing at this point would be to receive the report and refer to the ordinance committee. Is there anyone willing to make that recommendation?
I'll make that motion.
And seconded by Councilor Fritz. Any discussion?
Good idea.
Seeing none? Being referred to the ordinance committee. And item 470203. Receipt of report from the Planning Board of proposed amendments to the zoning ordinance regarding golf courses. This item, the Paputa Club, which was one of the parties involved in this, has asked that we table this item. The council could elect to do that or to accept it and refer it to the ordinance committee. Anyone prepared to make a motion on this one? Or
what's the reason why they want to table
it? Maureen, maybe perhaps we should have you... Give us a
letter D on page 2.
Hmm?
But they want to table it.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, Councilor Fritz.
May I just say that I'm going to abstain from these following two issues because I'm a stockholder at Perpudic.
This was asked to be tabled for what purpose?
John Mitchell, who's the representative of Perpudic, spoke to me yesterday about it, Monday. And, you know, we confirmed that it was on the agenda. We briefly spoke about that the planning board had changed the recommendation, and I asked him, what does the client think of the change recommendation? And he then said, I'd get back to you, and then he called me later and said that he'd spoken to a representative of the client, you know, the board chair, whoever it is, and they had asked for it to be tabled. And I didn't go into the details of why, but my sense is it related to whether or not the Perpudic Corporation had taken a position as of yet on the original recommendation versus what the planning board had recommended. I don't know that for sure, but that's my that's what I surmise.
I know there is a representative from Perpudic. Are you interested in speaking?
He's here on the liquor license.
Oh, okay. Sorry about that.
You're here on the liquor license.
Then you don't need to say anything. That's fine. No.
Mr. Chairman,
Councilor Lynch,
if it would be more efficient, rather than table it, I'm concerned that if we table it and then it comes back, we're going to refer it to the ordinance committee.
Correct.
So why don't we refer it to the ordinance committee, and then whatever the issues are can be discussed in the ordinance committee.
Fine.
And we may save a whole month.
Yeah.
I'll second that motion.
That was a motion, was it?
So my motion is to refer this item to the ordinance committee.
And a second from Councilor McGinty. Any further discussion on this item? Seeing none, all in favor? And show to be 6-0 with Councilor Fritz abstaining. Now the Perpudic Club again. Item number 48. 48-02-03, consideration of the annual renewals of the liquor licenses and special amusement permit for the Perpudic Club. And this is one of those traditional ones where it's just a housekeeping issue where the club has to have this license, has to be approved by the council, and typically there's not much to do about it. But again, the Perpudic Club is represented here. And I'll let you ask Councilor Carson, who's chomping at the bit, to make a motion.
I don't think that he needs to come up and discuss it with us. I just think this seems perfectly all right to me. And so I move that we approve the renewal application of the liquor license for the Perpudic Club.
Second.
I hear a second. Any discussion? Councilor Berry?
Well, I just noticed from the application that they filed here that there are 375 members here and that they've drank in the last year, $175,000 worth of liquor, and I think it's a real fun place, so I support this motion.
Okay. Any further discussion?
Just to clarify, that is the income for guests as well as for members.
You had to clarify, didn't you?
Having been a guest there occasionally.
All in favor of the motion? Anyone opposed? That carries 6-0 also. And item number 490203, consideration proposed tax reform initiative. I have asked Councilor Lynch if she would address this one as our finance chair and as our legislative policy representative to MMA. So, Councilor Lynch. And I did not give her much advance notice, so I'll mention that as well.
So I'm winging this. There are going to be two groups of people at the polls in November collecting signatures for two different referendums on property tax reform. One is a proposed referendum which is modeled after California's Proposition 13, which would cap property taxes at $10 per $1,000 of assessed value and freeze assessments at the time a property is purchased. Many municipal officials believe that this proposal would substantially harm municipal services and the provision of education to our young people. The Maine Municipal Association has proposed an alternative which is proposed to provide significant property tax relief to compel comprehensive tax reform at the state level,
right,
and to require additional funding of school services. The resolution that we have, that I'm proposing before the council tonight, is in response to the Maine Municipal Association's request that we endorse their referendum. And the one that we're putting forth basically says that we think that the Maine's overall property tax burden is a matter of great concern, that the other citizen petition, which is the Proposition 13 approach, would gut municipal services and cripple elementary and secondary education, and that the Town Council of Cape Elizabeth agrees that the aims of the Maine Municipal Association Citizen Initiative are admirable. I think we also recognize there are a lot of complicated issues that remain to be resolved in the Maine Municipal Association initiative, so this resolution urges our legislative delegation to make property tax reform a priority when they return to Augusta, and also urges all citizens to monitor these discussions and to fully inform themselves as they take action on these two petitions, whether it's in signing petitions or ultimately in voting next year. So that's sort of the sum and substance of it. I was trying to save Deborah from reading the entire resolution. I don't know if we can put this up on our website or if it's on the website.
Not yet.
Maybe after we vote on it, but all of the councilors have a copy before them. And that's what we're proposing.
On short notice, that was good. Thank you. I did ask the town clerk if she would mind reading it, and she said she did not. Does the council prefer that it be read or not? Mm. No. You're off the hook, Deb. And we will post the resolution then on the town website, www.capeelizabeth.com. And we need, a motion to accept the resolution, perhaps? Or do we even need a motion to do that?
We need a motion.
We need to move it. All right. Do I have a motion to accept the resolution as written and to be posted on the website?
So moved.
So moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Second. Any further discussion? Councillor McGinty?
I just want to make it clear that this is a big unknown. We don't know. In fact, we say in here, we don't know if this referendum passes and it gets the legislature, it may have a negative impact on our educational funding. We don't know that. This resolution simply asks that the voters take a close look at any referendum out there, as they should at any time, but that that we urge them, in light of competing referendums, that they be sure that they study both of them. And because I'm going to support this, but I don't want to come back a year from now and find out that because we support this referendum, the town of Cape Elizabeth ended up losing money. Our property taxes went up because we didn't have all the details of this. And I want to make that clear, that we don't know. There's a lot of unknowns, but that we're urging voters to take a close look at what's on the ballot.
Councilor Barry.
I think that Councilor McGinty makes an excellent point. And there are two main thrusts, as I see it, of this resolution. One is that the legislature support education with 55% funding, as they're required to do, rather than the 43% that they have been funding. That's the first point. And that they pay 100% of special education. And those are the two main thrusts, I believe, of this resolution, in addition to informing themselves. Also, I've suggested that we include the federal government in trying to acquire funds for not only special education, but education generally. And that's been included by the town manager in this draft. So with those reservations, I think that Councilor McGinney makes an excellent point. We don't have the facts. We don't have the number. We can support the concept, but we won't have the information to support or not support until a later time.
Councilor Swift-Kayetta.
I too, share your reservations, and I am indeed a member of the Executive Committee of Maine Municipal Association, and I have been sharing, have been a voice in the wilderness sometimes, I think, at some of those meetings, sharing these concerns that we all have about what will happen to the town, the citizens of Cape Elizabeth, if indeed either one or both of these initiatives pass. I understand that it is the MMA resolution is referendum is not perfect by any means. It is somewhat of a pig in a poke, but I am firmly convinced that the alternative one that will be presented at the polls would be a disaster the likes we have not seen in this state for local government and for local education. For that reason, I have been trying to work with the MMA to shape their proposal, and they have left it vague for a specific reason, and that is they think it has a higher chance of passing that way. And what we will all need to do as citizens is to work with and indeed probably pressure our legislative people, state legislative people, to work hard in the state legislature if this does pass, to work out the details, to make sure this is revenue neutral. At worst, this is revenue neutral, so that the people of Cape Elizabeth and the people all over the state don't end up paying more taxes because of this passing. But I am in support of this resolution because I think it states our concerns and our qualified support for the MMA referendum, and I think it also states our decided lack of support for the alternative that will be presented at the polls for people to sign. Thank you.
Councilor Fritz.
I have concerns about this whole issue. I will be supporting the resolution, but mostly because I think it really outlines the problem and says we need to search for some answers, but doesn't really support the MMA resolution necessarily. Because I agree the proposal that may be on the ballot to cap our taxes is a real problem. And just to point out, though, that, I mean, when they say 55% of school funding, that's a total for the whole state. And when you come to the school funding formula, I mean, right now the state is providing 43.6%, but we only get 12% of our school costs, as I figured it out, covering the cost of our students in Cape Elizabeth's education. If we go from 43.6 to 55 and the school funding formula stays in as it is, we will not get very much more money. We should not be misled that even this proposal would say we would get 55% instead of 12. Mm-hmm. The other thing is the 100% cost of special ed is very nice, but I just don't see that really happening with the budget shortfall we've got looking forward and the fact that this is a federal mandate, not a state mandate. I can't imagine the state legislators saying, sure, we'll fund that. So I don't know that this is very realistic. It's nice to have an option for people to think about. But again, you know, knowing the facts about it is what people need to search about, not just the rhetoric.
Thank you, Carol. Those are some great comments, the price stuff. Anyone else? I would just like to add, and I may ask the town manager to respond as well, but in fact, I maybe try to hit what he's on. The Pulaski proposal or Citizens Initiative, whichever you want to call it, currently our budget in this community is about $17 million, and under that, we would only be able to spend $7 million. So we'd lose $10 million, anybody thinks that any community, this one or any other one, could go from a $17 million budget for school, municipal, and county, could automatically just cut down to $7 million. It really needs to take a close look at that. And I guess for one counselor, I'm pleading with people, do not vote for that reason alone. It's just, it would be a disaster on our hands.
I just want to clarify your numbers a little bit. The amount that's collected from property taxes in Cape Elizabeth is $17 million. The entire municipal budget is a little over 20. Municipal schools, county, is a little over $23
million.
So the Carol Pileski proposal, the toughsome woman that there's a really good piece in Sunday's paper, I commend it to anyone to read. I won't go into any more details.
The manager was quoted in there.
I wasn't in that one.
Wasn't in that one?
I don't know. I have been before about her. Anyway, more seriously, what her proposal does is it requires properties to be capped essentially at a $10 tax rate. It also says that that needs to be based on 1997 values, which means that you need to go back to, you know, right now the state valuation is over $1 billion, according to the most recent state valuation. It would be down to around $700 million because property during those 5-6 years has gone up $300 million. That is, as Chairman Roberts mentioned, since we raised nearly $17 million from the property tax in Cape Elizabeth, and since we, based on our town's valuation, but since we need to go back to that 700, and we can only do it at $10, the 7 times the 10 equals 7 million rather than the 16.9 odd million. 10 million, to put that in perspective, the entire municipal budget, police, fire, public works, parks, collecting the taxes for the schools, everything, the library, amounts to about $7 million. So it would be like eliminating all municipal services and taking an additional $3 million out of the school budget. You know, that's not easily done because we still have debt, still have other... The proposal is preposterous at its face, but we also recognize people are upset about taxes. And people might be tempted to sign something just to send a message. Well, you know, I've given my opinion on the Pileski proposal. It is, you know, it really doesn't provide any safety net at all for anything.
Can I make one clarification? You mentioned debt. Pileski does not include, it exempts debt from.
But it's only debt issued before a certain date, and most of our debt is issued after that date. she also prohibits anyone from adding new fees. So, you know, if the thinking is, oh, they can find another way out of it. You know, her thinking, what she says is, you know, well, the state will somehow come up with the money. But, you know, if you read her whole history essentially is she does not believe in municipal government. And, you know, the strategy is essentially to remove it as an entity in the state. Well, she would deny that. But you read her history, and that's clearly
her motive. How about a motive?
Have we voted on this one yet?
We have a motion and a second.
That was my non-biased comment.
So we need to vote then. All right. Are we ready to vote? All in favor of the proposal as in your packet and to be posted on the web? Thank you. To show that to be unanimous as well.
We'll also, through the chairman, send that to all the legislative candidates who are running to represent Cape Elizabeth, to the congressional delegation, since it impacts some federal issues, as well as to Maine Municipal Association itself, so that they'll be aware of the council's position.
Item number 50-02-03, approval of voting delegate and alternate to the Maine Municipal Association Convention. This item each year, the Maine Municipal Convention is held in the fall, and we are allowed to have a delegate to vote on a number of issues at this meeting. Do we have anybody specified to be our delegate, or should it be Councilor Kayada, who is our MMA delegate to begin with? Or would somebody like to move that Ann be the...
I'll do it. I move it.
It's been moved.
Second.
And seconded that Ann would be the voting delegate.
Really,
all in favor? Yeah. And We need a motion for an alternate, and who else besides Ann is going? I know I am. Is anyone else going?
You're going?
I am going.
Well, then you're the alternate.
I nominate you as
the just got nominated.
Alternate.
Any further discussion? All in favor? Show it to be unanimous. Too bad they didn't all go that quickly.
I have a way of cutting to the nub.
And easily. Item number 51-02-03, consideration of proposed amendment provisions of the Spurwink Church. In your packet, you had some information there of a schedule change, et cetera, and I'm missing mine. What I do with it?
While you're looking for that, Mr. Chairman, this merely says if someone makes a reservation, you only have a couple of weeks within which to pay the money and to close the deal before we make it available for someone else to reserve.
Thank you. Do I have a motion to accept this change as presented?
Motion to approve, right?
Vote to approve.
Second.
All right. Any discussion on this item? Councilor Carson, was that a vote?
Voting.
All in favor of the motion? And you can show that to be unanimous as well. Item number 520203, consideration of proposed amendments to the library policy manual. And I think perhaps I'll let the town manager do that one as well. I'm sorry. He's here, isn't he? Bob, thank you for waiting so long. Okay. If you'd introduce yourself, please.
Sure. Hi, I'm Bob Steer. I live at 9 Rockcrest Drive. I'm a member of the Board of Trustees, and I'm here to explain a few minor changes that we've made to our acceptable use policy. The trustees acted on this in response to legislation that Congress passed called the Neighborhood Children's Internet Protection Act. That legislation provides that if we wish to take advantage of certain discounts for internet access and also funding under the Library Services and Technology Act, that the town, the library, is required to adopt an internet safety policy. And they are very specific about the issues that must be discussed in our internet safety policy, and those include such things as access by minors to inappropriate material, safety and security of minors using email, chat, and internet messaging, hacking or unlawful activities by minors, unauthorized disclosure of personal information regarding minors, and other measures to restrict access to harmful materials. We have an acceptable use policy. Arguably, it was already in compliance with the requirements, but just to make sure that there was absolutely no question, we've proposed the amendments to the policy manual that are set forth in our pages on electronic information services and network access. That's what those are intended to do, simply to make it clear that we're in compliance with the requirements of the Neighborhood Children's Internet Protection Act.
Bob, thank you.
Any questions?
Can we have a motion to accept this and then discussion, perhaps?
So moved.
And a second?
I second.
Okay. Henry, you had a question or a comment?
I was going to ask Bob just a second. Have you had any objections on First Amendment basis about censorship? Has anybody raised any issues along that line?
Well, there have the Act, there have been provisions of the Act that have been in litigation. These particular provisions have not been challenged by any organization.
Okay.
So nobody has raised these as any particular impediment to First Amendment rights. And in particular, they're not especially burdensome.
They're not the touchy ones.
No, they're not. They're not.
Right.
And they're all directed to making sure that minors are given adequate attention and protection by the libraries.
Sure. Thank you.
Anything else?
Don't go away.
Councilor McGinty.
Yeah. Under caveats on page, the document page 47, Mm-hmm. The first delete, going down in the right-hand column, the first delete box, can you tell me what was deleted there?
I think what was deleted was a space.
Just a space?
Mm-hmm.
Because this format kind of confused me, quite honestly, going through it. It was kind of difficult. So just the space was deleted.
Yeah, otherwise, when there has been a deletion, as you'll see above...
It says something in the box, right?
It's crossed out.
Yeah, parts. Yeah. It's crossed out?
No, it's...
Right. If, for example, when you see under the paragraph for access, the words "with the goal of" were deleted.
Right.
And in this case... there was a space before, an extra space before parents that was removed.
Okay, well, that answers my second
question. I think we needed that one, but that's all right.
Parents need a little space.
Any further discussion or questions, comments? Could we have a vote, then? All in favor of the motion? Show it to be unanimous. To the agenda this evening, if the council so desires or wishes, we have an addendum, two items. I don't know if we need to accept it, if we can just move forward. And I suspect that we have someone from Lutheran Church, perhaps, or...
Yeah.
And just a citizen. All right. A mother. Okay. I would like to take item 550203 first, then, and then get back to the other one. This gentleman's been waiting quite a while.
Chairman, point of order. Should we suspend the rules here because it's not on the agenda? I don't know.
No, it got on the agenda in a timely fashion, though. Didn't it get on? Didn't you post
it? They're on there. They're an addendum to our item. They are on it.
But it has to be on by, what, 2 days or
they're
something?
They're supposed to be...
I think Councilor Barry is once again...
Correct?
Correct.
Oh, got on? Just got on?
I hate to admit it, but another time tonight.
I'm hurt.
So we have to have a motion, then, to suspend our rules to accept...
I would so move.
Thank you. I hear a second.
Second.
We have a second. All in favor?
Yes.
Thank you. All right. Now, can we do item number 55 first?
What is
it? All right.
Item 55 first?
Yes.
Why?
We have somebody from that group here. We don't have somebody from the other group.
Okay. Then you have to make a motion to take items up out of order.
Do we?
Did I?
Oh, that's formality.
Quickly,
all right. Can we combine the two together?
Why don't we just do them quickly?
Just do them quickly, then. All right. Item number 54. You have the letter from the Shore Acres neighborhood. They...
We do? Yeah, there's a letter, and then there's that note from...
Is that this thing?
And the note from Debbie.
Is that one, and Debbie's note that we had earlier. The neighborhood association had some funds left over from a party they had earlier this year. They're having a business meeting. They've gotten their license from the church, or their license and their insurance. This is a technicality that technically, at another time, we might authorize the town clerk to represent the council on these anyway.
Can I ask why? I've never seen one of these before. Why now,
right.
Suddenly?
We'll let the town clerk address it then.
Okay. Yeah, what happened? It is unusual this evening that we have two similar items that I can't remember if I've ever seen.
I've never seen it.
As well. The first one for the Shore Acres Neighborhood Association is an application for a BYOB function. You have the details in their application of the date. It is going to be at St. Bart's. The second one is from the Redeemer Lutheran Church for an incorporated civic organization to have alcoholic there function. And again, their details are there as well. The requirement from this is actually through the State of Maine Department of Public Safety. Interestingly enough, the Department of Public Safety's application requires municipal officers' approval before it is forwarded to the Department of Public Safety. I think probably why that is to alert the municipality, the staff, the public safety, police, or what have you, that this event is taking place. My sense is that there may be similar activities that are held within the community that probably should be coming forth with some of these. But the second part to that is hopefully other groups that are holding similar functions have an off-premise catering license with a caterer who is authorized to have liquor. These are because of liabilities and so forth. So we are following the rules and the procedures of the Department of Public Safety
Is this a new policy of procedure? That's my question. I don't have a problem with
this. No, this is not. These applications have been around for a while. You know, as I say, they're, from what I'm told from the gentleman who is the liquor enforcement agency for this area, there may be other functions, and I'm not talking about this association or the Lutheran Church. There may be other functions at Sprague Hall, wherever, that may perhaps should be coming in for these, but they never asked for them. We're just hoping that they have licensed caterers, so
move it.
Councilor,
I must admit publicly, I'm a scofflaw, because as the president, of the Parents Association at the middle school, 3 years in a row, we ran a dance where,
say no more.
You're right.
Where parents brought their own bottles. And we really thought we were,
why don't you wait until the
rules.
Statute of limitations expires?
I think it did. It was like 100 years ago.
Okay. As I indicated earlier, I think it might be wise, maybe at another council meeting, to put an item on the agenda that would authorize Debbie to represent the municipal offices, and she could handle it right out of her office. It wouldn't need to come to the council. But for tonight, we need to act on these.
And I don't want to be a party pooper. I'll be supporting these, but I encourage that as well, because I don't want to have to vote on parties every month.
Right.
This is absurd. So let's get some generic fix to this on the next agenda.
Did you hear that? We want the next agenda, Debbie, to be authorized to do
so that we don't have to be the party.
It should be a town council goal to get this procedure straightened out.
We'll know everybody who's having a party in town.
Yeah.
All right. So do we have a motion?
So I will move the approval. Can I move the approval of both of these items at one time so we can take one vote?
Please. If anybody, somebody objects.
And I second both of them.
All right. Any further discussion, or whatever that qualified as? all in favor of granting the licenses to these two folks? Thank you for coming, and sorry we had to keep you so late. Now you're going to need that drink. Before we need to go back now to item number 53, but before we do, I'll ask the town manager, would you like a moment?
Just for the record, if the clerk could include it, if the council has no objection. Earlier this year, the council passed different photocopy fees, and part of the photocopy fee was 25 cents for each photocopy, initial photocopy. However, there was an exception for reference materials at the reference at the library of 5 cents. It was my understanding when that was adopted that what was meant by reference was that people were legally copying library materials. It was not intended to simply apply to books that were labeled as reference books. It was any research that anyone was doing at the library, as opposed to bringing in outside material for photocopying. The sense that we were going to, it's been very, very unpopular. Well, both are unpopular, but I really think it was the intent to allow people doing library research to be able to make the inexpensive copies. So I would, without council objection, there is no council objection for the record, I'd like to indicate that the staff is interpreting the nickel fee for copies relating to reference to be any research that's done in the library that's legally may be copied.
So,
go ahead.
So it was my understanding when we were talking about this that the 5 cent fee was for reference materials that do not circulate. Yeah, that's what I was thinking of. So you can't take them out of the library, so that's why it was the cheaper fee. So how are they interpreting it now? Is anything used as reference?
No, anything of library materials themselves. We find particularly students, they just want to make, 5 copies of something, to take with them, maybe to take and scan into their computers or whatever. And, what we're finding is, it ties into computer stuff. For the folks that can't afford their own computers, it's no problem for people to do it in their computers at home. For those that can't afford their own computers, they're doing an awful lot of this at the library. And what's happening is you know, we're really hitting those that are least able to pay, particularly students, and those that don't have computers at home.
Well, I have no problem with them interpreting it the way they're interpreting it currently.
But the policy was that we did tonight had 25-cent charge for if you print off something when you're using the computer. I mean, I think all of the charges that we've increased are really a problem. I mean, it seems to me that we ought to charge what it actually costs the town. Or if somebody takes in something to copy, even if it's not library material, if they copy it and don't need any assistance of the staff, then it doesn't seem like that's a... Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we should probably get in those. If we want to revisit it, that should probably be an item in and of itself.
Well, I had to add my two cents. The manager brought it up.
I raise it because it's an immediate issue with, you know, a lot of citizens. And I thought that I could get a quick clarification, but perhaps not.
I have no problem. Clarification. If you want to just go down.
I'm fine people. With the library's interpretation of reference.
Likewise.
Material.
Penny?
Fine. Otherwise, pick fine, 25 cents.
Yes.
Yeah.
She's fine.
She's fine with letting them interpret how they want to as far as reference.
How they are.
I'm not clear. You want them to be interpreting it as they have been interpreting
it? No, as they feel.
Or you're giving them the right to interpret it?
Yes.
I think they should have the right to interpret what's referenced.
Okay.
Right.
And the other issues is something else we could discuss also at a later date.
Thank you, Allison. Students and others will appreciate that.
Okay. We have, actually, we need to take something else out of order. I guess citizen discussion of items not on the agenda before we go into the, where was it? Somewhere here. Yeah, item number 53. So is there anybody from the public that would like to speak for an item that's not on the agenda? Well, good. Our student representative. And you can either go there or there. How's that? Name, address?
Rhiannon Gill, 89 Fowler Road, and I'm the SSC representative to the town council, or one of them. And I wasn't sure whether I was supposed to come and give my report at the beginning, but I do have a report to give you.
Good.
If you don't mind. Okay, we started to school back up at the very end of August, and within a couple of weeks we had events underway. One of our first major school events was on September 11th. We held the memorial ceremony, and that was opened and concluded by Principal Shedd. And at the ceremony, we reflected on the events that occurred 1 year earlier. We had speeches given by Chris Owens, who was the senior class president, Dave Faraday, who is the SAC chairperson, and also myself about a fundraiser that's currently going on for CARE Afghanistan, and they have a program called Community Organized Primary Education, which sends previously unable children to go to school in Afghanistan. And we also were privileged to hear from a World War II veteran, Mr. Stack, who is a graduate of the class of 1945 of Cape Elizabeth High School. Oh. Yes. At this ceremony, we also dedicated trees that were previously vandalized with a plaque, and these were donated by the classes of 2002. And 2003, and so those are dedicated now, and we would like to thank Public Works for helping get those in. And also, as far as events go, homecoming was last week. All throughout the week, we had spirit events on campus, as far as dressing in certain colors for certain classes and lunchtime competitions. And then this weekend was the actual homecoming. We had our cross-country teams and our football teams competing Friday. Football, they had a narrow loss, and cross country did pretty well. And on Saturday, we had the boys tie for soccer, we had the girls win for soccer, and we had the field hockey team win also. And also Friday was our bonfire and our pep rally. And even though it was raining, the fire department and Public Works helped us get out there and get it started. So we'd like to thank them again. That's pretty much it.
Thank you.
Rhiannon, thank you very much.
How narrow is a narrow loss for the football team?
Not really sure.
Thank you.
Rhiannon, in the future, when we're doing the council reports and stuff, we'll have you do it right then as well.
Okay.
All right?
Thank you.
Item number 530203, consideration of a request to enter into executive session to discuss land disposition acquisition matters. And I would ask the town manager.
I'm going to go into executive session to discuss land and disposition and acquisition matters. I'm sorry.
Second. And we have a second. And I believe the town manager did want to identify what that was.
Yeah, just briefly, I think whenever you put this on the agenda, that if it doesn't need to be a mystery, there ought not to be a mystery. There's two things. One is we've been approached by someone who's building a house on Highview Road, diagonally across the street from where I live, for the town to sell a lot to them that's undevelopable down on Eastfield Road. The issue is it's not part of the green belt or something like that. Should the town offer it to the abutters, and if so, at what price? And that would need to be discussed in executive session, particularly, the terms and, if you are interested in selling it with the dollar amount. Secondly, the council has a policy that when land becomes available adjacent to other town-owned property, that it be brought to the attention of the town council to see, to discuss it. In this particular situation, there's a house for sale on Fowler Road, and there's an issue with the Gulf Crest property about that we don't have any access to Fowler Road and to Great Pond to connect the Green Belt. And there's the issue of, since this is on the market, does the council wish to look at it with the possibility of maybe buying it, putting an easement on it, and reselling it? So those are the two issues, to see if there is interest in making an offer. But the particulars of it would need to be discussed in executive session. And on both issues, there wouldn't be any final action contemplated this evening. It's really kicking tires at this point.
And I'm not sure. I may have a conflict of interest on the one because the property right next to mine. I'm not sure if people feel I should be.
Do you have a financial gain?
No. I'll just raise it then so that people were aware of it. Okay.
It's good just to mention it.
Councilor Swift-Gayata.
I just wanted to suggest that before they turn the cameras off, you should read what our future meetings are, just for the public.
Thank you. I did have that on my list, and I forgot it.
Sorry.
Our future meetings are as follows. Thursday, October 10, the council will be meeting with the Conservation Commission and the Planning Board on the Gull Crest Master Plan and a budget update. Wednesday, November 13, 2002, regular town council meeting. Thursday, November 14th, we'll be meeting with the Planning Board and discussing the town center plan. Monday, December 9, is the regular town council meeting. And Thursday, December 12, we are holding for a workshop. So thank you for mentioning that as well. So at this point, I believe we can just adjourn to the executive session. And this session is over. Thank you very much.
Do we need a vote to go into executive session?
Do we need a vote to go?
We've
all in favor?